ultimate war machine. Nothing else on Earth is so densely packed with men and firepower. Submarines truly fought the Cold War. Yet for all their might, they are no match for the power of the sea. The submariner's deadliest enemy is not the other side. It is the ocean itself. The deep sea will seek out any weakness in his steel cocoon. It can rush in and drown him. It can crush his mighty vessel in a moment.
It's very humane in the sense that you are killed instantly.
But the sea can also imprison the submariner and kill him with hideous slowness. These are the tales of four ill-fated submarines and of the men who served on them. They are tales of tragedy and death, survival and courage.
We consider ourselves the elite force. We're all submarines, and we're all in this together, from beginning to the end.
Why do men brave this watery underworld? Where do they find the courage to face death? Who are the men of the Silent Service? April 20th, 2002. The USS Portsmouth Los Angeles-class fast attack sub leaves her base in San Diego, headed south. The US Navy's first line of attack, its last line of defense.
Sad journey down in there when you know that, hey, this is the last time I might see the light of day for a month or so.
Portsmouth is designed to disappear into the ocean. A nuclear reactor could power a small town, yet the boat makes less noise than the sea itself.
The thrill of sneaking around, that's the part I like. I like, you know, to sneak up on somebody, attacking, and they not knowing where it came from, and you're gone before they even realize what happened.
The Portsmouth's ears are her sonars.
Tom, sorry, gain new sonar contact, designate Sierra 5-6.
They can hear a ship almost 1,000 miles away, or the sound of shrimp feeding. Her torpedoes speed through the water at over 60 miles per hour.
Mark that.
This ship is built for war. It's built to basically destroy things.
Her Tomahawk cruise missiles can demolish targets 1,000 miles distant.
Doors raised to periscope death.
Confirm on the weapon.
Yes. Hey, shut the breach door.
Shut the door. Let's do it.
Reveille, reveille, up all bunks. Now reveille.
This awesome machine is manned by 134 men from across the country. Some from places not much larger than the boat itself.
I come from a small town too, 365 people.
They may go for months at a time without seeing the sun or breathing fresh air without word from home.
On board a submarine, there's activity going on 24 hours a day. The ship has to keep rolling.
You quickly lose sense of time. Like Monday and Tuesday, Sunday doesn't mean anything to you anymore. It's when do you stand watch? When do you do maintenance? And that's it.
Got it.
Always these men are in harm's way. and not just from the enemy. In some ways, the deep oceans are more dangerous even than deep space. Powerful and sophisticated as the modern sub is, it is still vulnerable. And when things go wrong, the consequences are too often deadly. August 2000, 6,000 miles from the Portsmouth's base. The Russian nuclear submarine Kursk is docked at the Zapadnaya Litsa Arctic Naval Yard. She is the billion-dollar pride of the fleet, as long as two jumbo jets. Kursk is designed to survive a direct torpedo hit, to be indestructible. Crewmen are very much like the men of the Portsmouth. Smart, professional, a close-knit brotherhood. These rare and intimate home movies show life on board the Kursk, including a curious initiation rite.
У нас было все здорово. То, может быть, если у меня служится служба, то служится именно по воду.
Ну все.
Все, мужик.
Да, еще да. На одного подводника.
Нашу полку прибыло.
Каждый находится на своем месте. Кто на боевом посту, кто-то осматривает отсек, кто-то выполняет.
Lieutenant Dmitry Kolesnikov commands the turbine compartment. 27 years old, he used to go out carousing with his buddies. But Dmitry recently married Olga. Now he seems to be settling down. Shortly before sailing, he takes Olga on a tour of the Kursk.
This is how I usually spend my time in an emergency. I lie over here like this and have a little sleep. And then the alarm goes. And bang! I keep hitting my head on that beam.
Olga and Dmitry are in love.
Say something memorable.
Memorable for whom?
For me.
Mitya, I love you. One morning, I woke up and realized that I loved him. That I couldn't live without him.
The Kursk, like any other sub, is run by amazingly young men. Men like 24-year-old Sergei Tillich.
He wanted to be an admiral. I'm very proud of my son.
His father was a submarine captain. Sergei followed him to sea. He was on deployment when his daughter Lisa was born. It was a month and a half before he saw her.
When I got home, I saw Sergei standing there with a huge bouquet of flowers, smiling. He gave me a kiss and said, "Quick, quick, open the door. I want to see Lisa. I want to see whom she looks like." We walked inside and he just stood there, looking at her, smiling. And he said, "I knew that children could look like their parents, but the way she looks so much like me, I never expected that." And he was very excited and very happy. Once I said to Sergei, "It's just a sub, it's like a tin can. If something happened, you'd be trapped and you wouldn't be able to do anything." He was very offended by my saying that. He even raised his voice at me. He said, "How can you say such things? That will never happen. This is the highest level of technology."
Yeah.
The last time I saw Sergei, we said our goodbyes as usual, and I asked him to be back by August 15th, which is my birthday.
I realized that he was in love with the sub, that he was prepared to stay on it forever, and that I would have to accept the fact that I had to share my husband with another woman, the submarine.
Like submariners anywhere, the crew was excited to be headed to sea. But all is not well. During loading, a torpedo is accidentally dropped on the quay. It goes aboard anyway. And Kursk steams out of the Zapadnaya Litsa base, headed for a series of exercises in the Barents Sea. August 12th, 0900 hours, the crew prepares for a practice torpedo attack. The cruiser Peter the Great is the simulated target. Northern Fleet Commander Admiral Popov gives the order to proceed. No one knows if they load the damaged torpedo. A U.S. sub, sister ship to the Portsmouth, is nearby, monitoring the Russian exercises. Suddenly, their sonar picks up a terrible noise. A blast ignites the Kursk's torpedo room. 2 minutes and 15 seconds later, the second massive explosion registers on seismographs designed to measure earthquakes. Mighty Kursk, huge and lethal weapon of war, is destroyed. Most of the crew are dead. But in the ninth compartment, 23 survivors huddle. No one knows if Sergei, Tilik, or Dmitry Kolesnikov are among them. Is there a way to save these men? For as long as subs have taken men beneath the sea, they've also taken their lives. The Civil War submarine H.L. Hunley was the first sub to sink a ship in combat. She was known as the murdering machine, but not because of the enemy she killed. Three of her own crews died on Hunley, and she herself sank. During World War I, the German U-boats proved lethal to Allied shipping. Yet thousands of German submariners died in their dangerous machines. Submarining became known as the coffin service. Yet to this day, men volunteer for duty on these boats.
It's the appeal of taking the ship to sea. It's knowing that we're making a difference whenever we go out.
We consider ourselves the elite force. We are all together in this. We're the front line of defense, we're the last line of defense. Think about countries in the world. They know about us. They fear us.
We've done things that you can only read about in a Tom Clancy novel.
You reach a stage where you depend on one another, you become much closer. Actually, closer than brothers. You know every move that person is going to make for every situation. And it's that way on every submarine.
You have to be very together. I mean, to go down not only in a submarine, but then to have someone trying to sink you. you get these little monsters come up in your mind, and you want out. You want to surface, and you want to open that hatch. You want out. You're not going to get out, so you just have to then go back inside and put everything back in order and calm yourself down.
You got a lot of guys you can count on here, you know? A lot of guys that you basically give your life to.
Too often, submariners did give their lives. In the early years, little thought was given to rescue. During the 1920s, a series of U.S. subs went down with tragic losses. Finally, one submariner, Charles Momsen, decided he would find a way to save men trapped in the deeps. He developed the Momsen lung, a kind of primitive scuba. It allowed submariners to escape a sunken craft from more than 200 feet down. With others, he soon developed a more ambitious rescue chamber that could save men trapped at greater depths. The chamber worked fine in theory, but had actually never been used to rescue anyone. It was about to get its first test. May 23rd, 1939. The USS Squalus is on patrol off New England. She is the most modern sub in the US Navy.
My name is Carl Bryson. In 1939, I was machinist mate second class on the submarine USS Squalus, and being commissioned in Portsmouth, New Hampshire.
The crew is preparing to make a test dive.
We were going from full speed on the surface to full speed submerged. They call a crash dive.
Throughout the boat, sailors man their stations. In the aft torpedo room is 33-year-old Sherman Shirley from North Little Rock, Arkansas. In 5 days, he is due to marry his sweetheart. His best man is electrician's mate, Lloyd Maness, on duty in the after battery. To submerge, all vents, valves, and hatches in the hull must be sealed. Lights indicate when the openings are secured. The trial begins.
We made the dive. Things went very well until all of a sudden, I heard on the sound-powered phones, take her up.
The engine rooms are flooding. The control board says the ship is sealed, but the valve that feeds air to the engines is open. The batteries start to short circuit. Any minute, they could explode and destroy the sub. Chief electrician's mate, Lawrence Gaynor, braves the deadly arcing electricity trying to reach the disconnect switch. Now the sub is without power. It's up to Lloyd Maness to seal off the flooded compartments and the crewmen stationed there.
Let's go, hurry up!
Some of them escape. With Squalus now sagging by the stern, Maness must haul the 250-pound door upwards. If he can't, they are all doomed. If he succeeds, he condemns his friend, Sherman Shirley. Twenty-six men are sealed beyond the door. Among them, Seaman Shirley. His best man, Lloyd Maness, knows there will be no wedding. 33 men have survived. Now, like the men on the Kursk, they are trapped at the bottom of the ocean. No one has ever been rescued from these depths. Carl Bryson remembers being down there.
Pitch black and quiet. Quiet like you can't imagine, just no sound. At that depth, the water's very cold, so everybody tried to get into a position of some kind of comfort. Waiting, naturally the thoughts go through your mind about the people that you know that are aft, like I had very close friends that were in the after part of the boat. In fact, most of my friends were in the after part of the boat.
There are two ways of dying on the submarine, quickly or slowly. Have they survived drowning only to die from suffocation?
And when you're waiting, it seems like forever. It may be only an hour or two, but it seems like forever, you know. And it was tremendous time before we ever heard anything.
The Squalus' sister ship, Sculpin, is overhead. The exhausted men try to signal the surface. At last, rescue boats arrive. On the deck of the USS Falcon is the rescue chamber invented by Momsen. Nobody knows if the untried chamber can save the men trapped below. Two men guide the chamber down a cable that divers have attached to the Squalus. First time in almost 30 hours, the stranded men glimpse a world outside the sub. Three times, the chamber ferries men to the surface and heads back down. Carl Bryce was in the last group to leave the boat.
Well, let's not tarry. Let's go, you know. So no, I was very glad to get in the bell to go up.
But as Bryson and the last of the men head up, something goes wrong. The haul cable jams, the bell will not move. All they can do is send a diver to cut the jammed cable.
So they dropped us back down in the mud. And that was a real setback because to me, I know there's no way to get out of the bell.
Bryson and the others are back on the bottom, wondering if they have escaped the sub, only to die trapped in the bell. There is a backup cable, but somehow it has become dangerously frayed. They must pull it in by hand. At last, the bell breaks the surface.
When I climbed out of the bell onto the Falcon, I was very, very happy to get there. People say, well, did you think you were ever going to make it out? Well, of course, I thought we were going to make it out.
To this day, it is the greatest submarine rescue in history. 33 men brought up from a watery grave like men brought back from the dead. Sixty years later, like the Squalus, Kursk is down in relatively shallow water. Can the Russian sailors also be rescued? On board Peter the Great, the commanders cannot believe the sub is down. Hours pass before an alert goes out.
The first few hours of a catastrophe are the most important. This report should have made the way to the top immediately. They should have gone to the president of Russia right away. That would have given the Navy commander more power.
It is nearly 30 hours before Russia launches a rescue vehicle.
В начале выпуска о чрезвычайном происшествии в Баренцевом море при проведении учений Северного флота.
Russian TV reports that the boat has suffered a technical malfunction and descended to the seabed on purpose. Rumors of the truth come to the submariner's families waiting in the military town of Vidyaevo.
I was told by my friend that Kursk was lying on the bottom. I thought at first it was a joke. I said, who told you such nonsense? That couldn't happen. Kursk simply could not be lying on the bottom.
I heard about it August 14th on television. They said that the submarine was lying on the bottom. At the time, I didn't take the news seriously. Because Mitya told me that nothing bad could happen to Kursk.
The phones were always busy. But finally, I got through to Sergei's mother.
I scolded her. Don't you believe anybody? It can't be lying on the bottom. Such a submarine can't just be lying on the bottom.
The mothers and wives don't know what to believe. Navy officials give contradictory accounts.
С подводной лодкой установлена связь. Имеется контакт с личным составом.
Я думаю, к сожалению, что имеются жертвы и значительные.
Мы сейчас приступили снова к этапу спасения.
Была информация, что эвакуация уже началась.
Имеется в виду этап спасения.
We got many different reports. Most of them gave us hope. Because we were told that they had established communication with the sub. That they heard tapping.
Despite official claims, the Russian rescue submersibles failed to dock with the Kursk.
For several days, we have made attempts to enter the submarine. But it's very difficult. There are strong underwater currents right near the sub. It's very hard to dock with the escape hatch.
However, the Russian Navy refuses offers of help from the US and others. With each passing hour, the chance of rescuing anyone fades. Too often, Soviet submariners faced disaster when their boats failed. Yet sometimes, the bravery and determination of the men triumphed. One of the most extraordinary incidents takes place aboard the Soviet sub K-19. She is the Soviet Union's first nuclear submarine armed with ballistic missiles. K-19 is under the command of Captain Nikolai Vladimirovich Zateev. The son of a factory laborer, he commanded his first sub at the age of just 26. Now at 34, he is captain of the greatest submarine in the Soviet Navy. April 1961, K-19 is undergoing trials. Zateev is concerned that a US sub might try to monitor their secret mission. A submarine's own propellers mask any noise from behind, so K-19 periodically zigzags to listen for a pursuer. Sure enough, sonar picks up a telltale noise. K-19 has a U.S. submarine on its tail. Unable to shake the enemy, she steams on. Some days later, K-19 is on the surface. when Zateyev hears a shout from the lookout. He rushes to the bridge. The U.S. submarine is bearing down on them at high speed. It is the USS Nautilus. They are on a collision course. With their engines running full reverse, K-19 slows just in time. They pass within 3 yards of each other.
I made a report to my commander on the exercise that we had just completed. During the conversation, he said, "I reported your encounter with the American submarine to Admiral Gorshkov. He told me to tell you that you should have rammed it." So I said, "I'm not a pirate." And I simply couldn't do something like that.
3 months later, in July, K-19 heads to sea again for a series of war games. Cold War competition means K-19 has been rushed into service to counter the sophisticated U.S. subs.
There was such pressure within the Soviet government to catch up with the United States that they were sending these ships to sea, ill-prepared, not adequately tested, and with insufficient safety measures and insufficient training.
In the early morning hours of July 4th, 1961, Zateyev is in his stateroom. The naval exercise is going well, and the commander is pleased with his sub's performance. But just after 0400 hours, disaster strikes. An alert comes over the intercom. One of the reactor's coolant loops is leaking. Pressure in the system plummets, sending temperatures soaring. The reactor is headed for meltdown. At 0600 hours, Zateyev orders the sub to surface to send an emergency signal. He discovers that K-19's long-range antenna is flooded. Now they are completely alone in the icy Norwegian sea. There is one way for Zateyev to save his boat. He must send men into the nuclear reactor compartment to connect a makeshift coolant line. It is a suicide mission, but 8 men step forward, among them Lieutenant Boris Korchilov. 23 years old, he is a favorite of the crew.
It was an agonizing decision assigning this task. I asked the team leader, Boris, "Do you know what you're going into?" And he replied, "Yes, I do." But it is very difficult to send someone to their death, and I knew he'd probably receive a deadly dose of radiation.
They did this not only because of duty, but because of camaraderie and the esprit de corps that you had on board a closely knit submarine like that, and that the officers and the crew of a submarine will do anything to save one another.
Even if it means dying. Their protective gear will do little to shield them from the radiation. Toxic compartment, they work with lengths of salvaged piping, desperately trying to cool the reactor core. K-19 wallows in the frigid waters, without hope of rescue. Zateyev returns to the reactor compartment to find that his men have paid an awful price.
When they came out of there, the first thing was vomiting. Yellowy froth coming out of their mouths. We held them and they reported they'd done the job. There, in front of my eyes, they started to swell up.
Their sacrifice has prevented a meltdown, but the crew is marooned on a boat that is now lethally radioactive. There is no escape. To flee for home means certain death.
We'd never have made it to base. Well, we would have, but by then everyone would have received a lethal dose of radiation.
100 miles away lies Jan Mayen Island. It is a NATO listening post. Zateyev will not surrender a prize like K-19 to the West. There is one other option. Zatayev remembers a squadron of Soviet diesel subs operating to the south. If he can find them, he can save his crew. If he misses the subs in the vast sea, they are doomed. Gambling with the lives of his men, he orders K-19 south, away from home, away from Yan Mayan Island. In the sick bay, the irradiated men are dying. If Zatayev cannot find the Soviet subs, this is the fate that awaits them all. On the bridge, the crew scans the sea for signs of hope. K-19 steams south for hours. But finally, on the horizon is another submarine. They are saved. The pack of diesels transports the crew of K-19 to safety. Boris is doomed, as are the others who sacrificed their lives to save their boat. Days after reaching home, 8 will die, another 14 not far in the future. Some, like Ivan Kulikov, braved the radiation and survived, but with horrible injuries.
Some moments I remember, some I don't. I remember how they strip off the skin from my hands, peeled it off simply using tweezers. Afterwards, they put on some compressor and put cooling fans next to me to ease the pain.
The astonishing sacrifice these men made was never publicly acknowledged. It was kept secret for almost 30 years. Yet their heroism saved the lives of their shipmates and averted a nuclear disaster. Ultimately, the men who died on K-19 were killed by the Cold War, rushed to sea on boats that were still largely prototypes. But when East-West tensions were at their height, the U.S. was also pressing its subs into service. Just 2 years after K-19 averted nuclear catastrophe, the USS Thresher went down off New England. Even today, it remains the deadliest submarine disaster in history. In 1963, Thresher was the most modern sub in the U.S. Navy.
She was designed to be the deepest diving, fastest submarine in the world. Also, the quietest.
Ray McCool was a reactor control officer on the Thresher.
Thresher was a solid, excellent war machine. The Navy was counting on that to try to stay one step ahead of the Russians.
But trouble dogged the boat, from a collision to battery problems.
Her initial attempt to submerge to a test depth resulted only in twisting her hull, and she never could get down to test depth. The ship had so many problems, a hell of a lot of work to do.
April 1963. Thresher has been in dock for 9 months undergoing a complete overhaul. Now she is finally ready to begin her trials.
We didn't get out very far, and we found the main seawater suction valve would not go shut. We turned around and went back in, and there was a radio message waiting for me that my wife was in the hospital.
McCool stays behind to care for her, and Thresher heads back to sea without him. Miles off Cape Cod, she plans to descend to her maximum depth, 1,300 feet. Down there, more than 40 tons of water pressure bear down on every square foot of the hull. To begin with, all goes smoothly. Until suddenly, the rescue ship Skylark waiting above Thresher gets a cryptic message.
Experiencing minor difficulty. Have positive up angle. am attempting to blow.
No one is sure what this means, but on Thresher the problem is far from minor. As the sub nears test depth, it seems a pipe joint fails.
The ocean is now trying to come in. The water is coming in at such a velocity that it atomizes. It basically turns into mist. Well, that mist now can permeate the compartment much more than just a straight shot of water, and apparently shorted out one of their major buses. And when that happens, the submarine's nuclear reactor scrams, which means it shuts down.
Thresher is now without power and in terrible danger.
They're losing buoyancy and they're starting to slip down. And they didn't have to slip far.
Deep in the ocean, they are on the very margin of life and death. At 9:18 in the morning, the magnificent Thresher loses its fight with the sea, slips below its crush depth, and implodes, crushed like a tin can, then ripped apart by the unimaginable power of the ocean.
It's very humane in the sense that you are killed instantly. And the submarine was just shredded. It's like a giant, giant bomb. A bomb that you can't even imagine the power of, that just took that submarine and shredded it. And that's it. And then it just, down it goes. But the game's over.
It's beginning to sink in. Still difficult to believe.
I couldn't believe that the ship could be down. It was just not possible. I don't believe there's any way to describe your feelings when you lose a close shipmates. Every year they have a Thresher memorial, and they have a sounding of the gong, and they name each name. I don't go to them anymore.
The Navy sent its most sophisticated deep-sea submersible to search for the wreckage. They recovered one piece of mangled pipe. A mile and a half down in the blackness, Thresher had been reduced to little more than scrap metal, the final resting place for 129 men. In 1984, underwater explorer Robert Ballard used a deep-sea robot to map the wreck site for the Navy.
When you're viewing it, you're viewing something very sad. And it's the little boys and little girls that daddy didn't come home and the husband didn't come home. And the repercussions of that shock wave that went through so many other people's lives is what you think about, actually. I have a little girl, a little boy I want to go home to.
We probably will never know the exact chain of events that killed Thresher, but the ultimate cause may have been the Soviet threat. Like the Soviets, the U.S. felt a pressing need to get its subs to sea.
I knew that she was not ready for sea, but the commanding officer had no alternative. He was being directed by his seniors, get the ship to sea.
Thresher was needed to fight the Cold War, and perhaps she was sent to sea before she was truly ready. The Navy launched a huge program called SubSafe to improve design and safety standards. They developed a modern rescue vehicle to supplement the chamber used on Squalus. This deep-sea rescue vehicle could not have saved Thresher. If the Russian Navy had requested it in time, a submersible like this might have saved the men trapped on Kursk. But more than 4 days after the Kursk went down, the Russians are still refusing all foreign assistance. Deputy Prime Minister Ilya Klebanov finally calls a press conference.
Saturday was the latest they could have communicated with us.
Bye.
Sergei's mother is eventually injected with sedative. Here in the former Soviet Union, her public anger and the fact that cameras are there to record it is astonishing. For more than a week, the frantic wives and mothers hope against hope that the submariners can be rescued.
I believed for a long time that Mitya would be rescued because he was supposed to be in one of the rear compartments.
Russian Navy officials finally admit they cannot get to the men on board. A Norwegian and British rescue team is called in. Paul Dinesen is the first diver down.
I really wanted to go because even if there was only one person we could have saved, or at least try to save, it'd be worth it.
The divers use a bell to descend.
The bell takes about 6, 7, 8 minutes to get down. Water comes in, the hatch opens, and you climb out. And then turned around and I look down, and I see like a whale with a big silver eye looking at me. I remember landing on the sub and I think, my God, I'm standing here. Inside I really hoped, because you never know. Miracles do happen.
Before they can open the hatch, they must check the pressure inside. If anyone is alive, they cannot risk flooding the compartment. As they crack open the hatch, they use milk to monitor whether water is sucked in, meaning there is still air inside.
Right, if you get any flow going in, you close it. You understand? Any flow in, you close.
But the milk just floats there. Now they know. The entire crew of the Kursk, 118 men, is dead. After days of blank-faced lies from officials, Fleet Commander Admiral Popov appears on television.
Life must go on. Raise your children, raise your sons. And forgive me for not being able to save your men.
Когда идет молодой лейтенант, мое сердце оно просто разрывается.
За кто это?
When she grows up, I will tell her the whole truth about Sergei. I will try to explain it to her the best I can, in language she can understand. I want to raise her to resemble Sergei's character. But I also want her to look like him, because she is the only living memory I have of Sergei.
What finally killed the last of the Kursk crewmen? Investigators believe an oxygen regenerating device caused an explosion that sucked the remaining oxygen out of the compartment, and the men suffocated. We still don't know when this fatal fire broke out. Initially, officials claimed 8 hours.
8 hours is a very convenient figure. If they only survived for 8 hours, then there was no chance of saving the crew. And if there was no chance of saving them, there are no guilty parties.
But there are reports that the tapping continued for 2 or even 3 days after the sinking.
If they admit that the crew survived for 2.5 or 3 days, it raises a question. Why were they not rescued?
In October, they started to bring the bodies up, and they made a startling discovery. Dmitry Kolesnikov had a note tucked into a pocket. On it was a journal entry.
It's pitch dark and difficult to write, but I try and write without seeing. I don't think we have any chances now. I just hope someone will read this. Don't despair, Kolesnikov.
Kolesnikov, Sergei, and the other crewmen gave their lives for something they loved and believed in. They knew the dangers of the deep, like the men of Squalus, Thresher, K-19, and Portsmouth. Submariners know that each time they go down, they may not come back.
You have a chance of dying, but look what you're dying for. You're dying for your country.
If you're doing something dangerous, obviously, there's some challenge behind that. I mean, there's a risk involved, but I'm willing to take the risk.
You learn from each other. You learn from each other's experiences. And there's a good teamwork and camaraderie around the ship.
We're good at what we do. I think we're the best in the world.
Unseen, largely unacknowledged, they journey into the alien world of the oceans, ready to risk their lives for their country, for each other. Sailors, warriors, a band of brothers.